Hey friends, Brendan here. You may not know this, but smartphone sales have not only plateaued in sales over the past few years, but they're even beginning to decline. There's a good bet that the phone that you're holding right now is at least 2 years old, if not even older. Let me know if I'm right in the comments and what phone you're using. If you're one of the people writing in the comments right now, then companies have a problem with you, and they're trying to get you to upgrade any way they can with every piece of tech and awful gimmick they can come up with, and there's nothing we can do to stop it. Let's talk about it, because this is Tech Today. Please share, subscribe, hit that bell icon to be notified of when I post another video, and give this video a thumbs up. I'd really appreciate it. So let's talk about some context. Since last year, I've been talking about the data we've been seeing about smartphone sales, stating that Apple and Samsung, amongst others, were heading to a really scary place if they cannot turn around the slowing sales of their smartphones. While smartphone sales were growing year to year in the previous years, 2018 was the first year that smartphone sales didn't grow. In fact, they had declining sales for 5 quarters straight with an annual decrease of 4% annually and 7% in the fourth quarter. That's a lot. Even if other companies like Huawei were gobbling up market share from Samsung and Apple, that still didn't address the issue that overall, global shipments of smartphones were and still are declining. This led to the drama of Apple having to adjust their shareholder guidance for the Christmas season, resulting in the Apple stock halting on the stock exchange. I made a video about what that all meant, which you can check out up here. Samsung has had their fair share of burden as well, with multiple financial misses not only from smartphone decline, but from other manufacturers not using their parts, like their memory and storage chips or displays. In fact, they had to fine Apple nearly $700 million because Apple didn't end up using all the displays they said that they needed from Samsung. Despite the fine, Samsung's profits fell 56% year over year. That's terrifying for a business. But why is everything kind of falling apart? Why are people not buying smartphones? Well, the first problem is that the market is saturated. All the feature phones and flip phones of the past have mostly been replaced by smartphones. Even your grandma probably has a smartphone. But there's also that one dude at work that insists on keeping his flip phone until he dies for some reason, but he doesn't count. There's always that one dude, right? Are you that one dude? But most people that want to have a smartphone that didn't have one before has one now. On top of that, the smartphone has matured, which means there really isn't any groundbreaking advancement that makes people feel like they absolutely have to upgrade. Plus, their phones are lasting a long time and people are just satisfied with them, and that's actually a good thing, at least for us the consumer, right? Then there's the often vocalized frustration over smartphone prices, which have surpassed $1,000. That is, if you get the flagship models that companies tell you that you have to get and advertise for so heavily. People are just holding on to their device for a long time, and it's the result of any combination of the things I just mentioned. The reality is, these companies can't allow this slump to continue, so they're gonna do something about it. And what is that? Well, in comes the gimmicks. Oh, the gimmicks. What if we just make the phones bigger? Wait, we can't make them even bigger, so what if we reduce the bezels even smaller? By a millimeter. Another millimeter. What if we keep making the screens bigger until we can't really put the camera on the front like normal anymore? Let's make a notch. Ah, but people don't like the notch. We need even less bezel. So, let's do a punch out, a Galaxy S10 perhaps. Or let's add an even more complicated and potentially fragile camera with movable parts and a motor. Or what if we removed certain features that are helpful for less bezels? Who cares if you can't hold on to it normally anymore? We're in this phase where companies are doing the what if we do this, will this make people buy new phones? It's a strategy that companies have been trying because their phones are already so good that there's not a ton that they can realistically improve on in the short term that's going to be groundbreaking. Even though the OnePlus 7 Pro is amazing and it's really just a screen in your hand all the way around, it's not mind-blowing, is it? But don't get me wrong, this phone is awesome, but it's not revolutionary. Can you tell how I feel about this? You know, there's a vocal minority constantly asking for less bezels until all they're holding is a screen. Then the phone comes out, it's crowned as the GOAT. And then people who demand less bezels don't even buy it, either because they don't need to upgrade, don't want to, or can't afford to pay for these revolutionary screens as phones. That is the reality of it. You'd be surprised how many people argue for a phone they don't even own in my comments. It's insane. Companies then look to find something else beyond less bezels to tempt us to upgrade. I mean, there's only so much bezel you can get rid of. So they go all out and make it foldable. But that's super expensive to buy and hasn't really worked out too well, huh? R.I.P. Well, what if we make the screen a high refresh rate? Well, as much as I personally love that and I want it, it's not a good enough reason for someone to give up their existing phone and spend money. So what gimmicks are companies going for now? And keep in mind, this is all while increasing the overall cost because they're adding more expensive things even though the standard things are decreasing in price. Fingerprint scanners. Yep. Fingerprint scanners. And it's not just a normal one, like you find on the Pixel phone. It's an in-display fingerprint scanner. Yeah, the ones that are built into the screen, an in-display fingerprint scanner. I hate this thing. It's locked out. Okay, let me explain. First, the thought of it seems really cool and futuristic in a way, but that is more futuristic because I'm a nerd and I understand how big of a feat it is to make something like that. The everyday person, the average Joe, they don't really know what is futuristic about it. I've yet to find someone freak out over an in-display fingerprint scanner like they have over the Galaxy Fold. I've asked them about it and they're confused as to what I'm pointing out. I then tell them about the in-display fingerprint scanner and they just go, cool. cool. That's it. It doesn't mean anything to them and it doesn't actually matter. In fact, they're more interested in the pop-up camera. But that's not why I hate this thing. I understand why companies are trying to do this, but the real reason I hate this thing, the reason why I don't think in-display fingerprint readers are the future you want, that I want, and is the reason why I'm making this video, the real reason why I hate this thing is simply because it sucks. What may seem cool on paper and in the ads and what it's like to actually use are completely different things. First, it just isn't reliable and fast. Whenever there is a new technology that replaces an existing option, especially one that is already mature, you'd expect it to at least work as well, better, or at least super close to the same if it isn't as good as before. The current options we have are just not as good. The Galaxy S10 constantly refuses to read my fingerprint properly, which results in me having to try many times over and having the fingerprint reader locked out. I have to use my pin then. The OnePlus 6T had the same issue with it not unlocking unless I placed my finger perfectly on it. To be fair though, the OnePlus 7 Pro is much faster and more reliable there, but there's an issue with that. With OnePlus, the technology they're using for the in-display fingerprint reader is not as secure. There was even a group that was able to unlock it simply by putting something reflective enough, like aluminum foil, where the sensor is, and it worked. OnePlus quickly addressed this, which is good, but let's be honest here. This group unlocked it simply because fingerprint residue was still in place and aluminum foil, something anyone can get, was able to unlock it. And yes, many of you are probably thinking, what about the face unlock? Well, that's a big problem. The OnePlus 7 Pro does offer a face unlock, and it's not secure at all. Let me just show you. All right, so here's a OnePlus 7 Pro, and I'll unlock it with my face. It's unlocked, okay. And then here's the profile picture from my Twitter profile, just kind of enlarged, so it's even a low quality image. That was so fast. So when I point it at a screen of a picture of me, it still unlocks. This is not secure at all. So yeah, the OnePlus 7 Pro is the fastest for unlocking your phone with both technologies, but it's not nearly as secure. And I'd even argue it's not really secure at all. You're sacrificing speed and convenience over privacy, which I don't think you should at all. And this was a huge source of drama earlier, right after the launch of the Galaxy S10. There were a ton of articles and videos about it if you want to check those out. There's a link to Lou's video in the description. The main thing to realize is how insecure these options are. And if it's more secure like the Galaxy S10, it's more fickle. It's even worse if you have a screen protector on it, which stinks if you want to protect your phone that costs you hundreds of dollars. And this technology can also damage your screen or make it discolored. With my Galaxy S10, I noticed this when I was outside and looking at a web page that had a white background. A sort of discoloration where the fingerprint scanner is, which isn't centered by the way. If you're concerned about things like screen burn-in, then in-display fingerprint readers can do that too, in a way, depending on which tech they use. Thankfully, you mostly notice this only on white backgrounds and in brighter light, so maybe that's not a deal breaker or annoying enough for you. To be clear, this doesn't bother me, but I think it's worth mentioning. But for the OnePlus 7 Pro, you may see some discoloration. This technology was mentioned by Mr. Who's the Boss in an episode, and he stated that you may have some image burn-in because of the really bright light that was emitted to scan your finger. But to give context, the video I'm referring to was also a sponsored video for a competing product from Qualcomm. So take all that with a grain of salt and do some additional research. Anyways, this is a massive step back. And you may say, but Brennan, this is generation one. They'll get it worked out and improved in the next one. And that's totally understandable, but don't release it out on the flagship model where you don't really have a choice but to use that new tech before the kinks have been worked out. This stinks for the person who needs to upgrade their phone or the employee that has the company upgrade coming up and they only have a limited number of phones that they can choose from. Or the grandma or parent that just buys whatever's put in front of them at the store. At least put it in the lower tier devices that aren't as widely sold and work out the kinks to get it all working relatively as good as what you're replacing. The last thing you want to do is to get a new product that has new technology in it that replaces old technology and the new technology is worse. That's what's happening and there's nothing we can do about it. There's nothing you can do it other than not buy it. If we have a choice. And choice, that is the issue. We may not have much of a choice if we look to buy a flagship now or in the near future. Samsung has really embraced this, OnePlus has embraced it, Google seems to be embracing it for the Pixel 4, and it's even rumored that Apple is embracing it for a special model in China. In the case of the Galaxy S10, get the S10e. It has a capacitive scanner on the side, is cheaper, and is still an amazing phone, especially at that price. So there's at least one choice. I guess on the bright side, in-display fingerprint readers don't disrupt the look of the back of your phone as much, so you can slap on a skin by our new channel sponsor, Dbrand. You can now maximize the custom look of your device to avoid those fingerprints with this awesome swarm skin, or get this clean-looking grip case with a matrix skin on it. There are links in the description to pick some up. With that said, what is the real change that is going to get people to upgrade? 5G. At least that's what all the analysts and industry professionals are saying. 5G is probably what will do it, but it's just not ready yet, and probably won't be until mid-2020 at the earliest. Even then, if you don't need to upgrade your phone until the end of 2020 or sometime in 2021, just hang on to your phone and buy a 5G phone then. Hopefully, the prices of 5G will come down in price as well, but that may be a stretch. Even though 5G will be a significant and practical change, I'm not entirely sure if it'll get the masses to upgrade quickly. If you, the person you sit next to at work, your parents, or your grandparents are fine with how fast the internet speeds are while they're on the go, why pay a phone and pay more for 5G, especially if it's not widely available yet? I guess that's the problem for these companies to figure out. Hopefully we get less gimmicks and more helpful features. Let me know what you think, and if you disagree with me, let me know if you actually own and use a phone with an in-display fingerprint reader for your main device if you disagree with me. I'd love to know why you disagree with me. Does the lack of security bother you or not? Let your voice be heard, but also be gracious, thoughtful, and considerate of others. Also join the This is Tech Today Community Discord chat server. It's a great place with some great people, so join us. Thank you for watching This is Tech Today, where we talk about the intersection of technology in our everyday lives, in business, and in all things creative. Until next time.